The formula of a Tolkien quest is pretty straightforward. You take one tiny furry guy and one long furry guy, and together they go on a cheeky quest with the boys to Elrond's place, then fail to go over the Misty Mountains, go under them instead, through a forest to get to another mountain, any mountain will do, where they help save the day before returning home to the Shire. Oh, and also there's a magic ring. And Gollum. And to introduce us to Middle-earth, we start out in the Shire, a place which strongly resembles Victorian England and its culture, with waistcoats and postal service and clocks. But then as we venture farther away, we get more old-timey, ending up in places that more closely resemble Beowulf's time than Victorian England. So we kind of get the sense of moving backwards in time. And Tolkien designed for us as our hero the perfect underdog, the Hobbit. Frodo's story isn't that of a great Superman G.I. Joe hero with superpowers and glory. Frodo's story is that of a little guy against incredible odds who manages to save the world. Tolkien once said, "I've always been impressed that we are here surviving because of the indomitable courage of quite small people against impossible odds." And that's what the story is about. It's not really about Aragorn, it's about Frodo and Sam and Merry and Pippin, the ultimate underdogs, just trying to do their best for their small part. And this time, they win. And they save the world, and save the home they so desperately want to protect. So when Amazon acquired the rights for The Lord of the Rings, they had a pretty easy task for creating a sequel or a prequel. Just follow the Tolkien formula. Really, the whole point of The Rings of Power is just to be nostalgic. We want to remember how we felt about the Peter Jackson films 20 years ago. The show doesn't even have to be particularly good, just nostalgic. Oh, look at the little hobbits. I remember the Mines of Moria. Wow, so pretty. Look at Elrond when he was still young and gay. But for some reason, Amazon reckoned they knew better and decided to make an epic quest about an ancient elf with a vengeance, because what Middle-earth really needed was more Batman vibes.
The hell are you supposed to be?
I'm vengeance.
This was why The Rings of Power was always going to be kind of a disappointment at best, but, well, that's not why the fans were mad. Amazon had dared to make two major changes to the Legendarium. Galadriel had a sword, and some of the people were not white. The Galadriel we all remember from The Lord of the Rings is tall and beautiful and elegant. She wears beautiful white dresses and floats about her elven realm dreamlike, stoic, if occasionally a little emotional. Galadriel's also incredibly old, meaning that for a prequel series, she can easily be brought back no matter when the show's set. So Amazon cast her in the role of the hero, seeking revenge against Sauron for the death of her brother, a new storyline which doesn't appear in any of the books. So we get a version of Galadriel almost filling the Aragorn role, center stage with a cool knife and curvy armor. And fans were enraged at the defilement of a favorite character, decrying this warrior version. But actually, Tolkien probably wouldn't have been particularly bothered by warrior princess Galadriel. He once described young Galadriel as being of Amazon disposition, insert Jeff Bezos joke here. And let's be real, Tolkien created Eowyn, the original feminist horse girl, the sixth spice girl, horse spice. As a stan of Old Norse mythology and Old English literature and fairy tales, Tolkien was well acquainted with warrior women and their historical precedent. When he was a kid, he read The Girl Who Pretended to Be a Boy, a Romanian fairy tale about a girl who dresses up as a guy and decapitates a dragon. Sound familiar? What makes Eowyn different from the Old English and Norse warrior women is the sexism she faces. Tolkien inserted an explicit patriarchal barrier that Eowyn had to face, and in doing so, he made her an underdog. So, like Frodo and Bilbo, Eowyn's narrative is of someone who is considered small and unimportant, facing impossible odds. Eowyn is underestimated by everyone, just like Merry, who she takes along on her journey. But because their own allies underestimate them and hold them back, they push through and kill the Witch King of Angmar, the leader of the Ringwraiths, just as Frodo destroys Sauron by managing to get the ring to Mordor. Aragorn is literally just the distraction in the end to help Frodo and Sam, and leaving Eowyn to fight the Witch King. I think Tolkien had kind of seen himself in that role of underdog in the First World War. He was a nerdy little weakling sent to fight a battle so much bigger than him, just like Frodo. So if Batman Galadriel isn't the underdog at war, who is? The main hobbit of The Rings of Power is a new character named Nori. As we've seen, hobbits are perfectly designed to be the small person against impossible odds, except Nori doesn't face impossible odds. Occasionally something mildly annoying or wacky happens in her life, but she's hardly struggling. Her main struggle is that she finds the nomadic life of her nomadic people boring, so she wants to go traveling. She dreams of a bigger, better life for herself, like she wants to see her name in lights in the big city. It's all terribly American.
Haven't you ever wondered what else is out there? How far the river flows, or where the sparrows learn the new songs they sing in spring?
I wanna be
where the people are.
Maybe Bronwyn, a healer experiencing prejudice because of her crush on an elf, fits the underdog role best. Her home is attacked by orcs and ultimately is destroyed by them, but Bronwyn is far from being the central character to the story, and I think all the Southlands drama would barely have changed if she was cut from the show entirely. But Galadriel, on the other hand, is most definitely not an underdog. She's a warrior conspiracy theorist who luckily turns out to be right about her conspiracy theories most of the time.
This mark was left as a trail for orcs to follow.
How did she guess that? She's aristocratic, she's basically royal, a cousin to King Gil-galad himself. I guess it's kind of sad when she gets sent to Valinor, which is, you know, paradise and heaven, basically, where she would possibly find her resurrected brother who she misses so much. Instead, she gets washed up on an island where people are racist against elves, which is really tough for her, except things are quickly turned around and she ends up commanding an army of them after a few days, so that's very fortunate. Galadriel is just not an underdog. She's too epic, too powerful, too perfect. And while I don't think Tolkien would have been bothered by how strong she is, I think another change to her character would have bothered him far more. She's fucking tiny. The book Galadriel is very tall, 6'4", taller than most men and as tall as her husband, and she has a deeper voice than most women. Her mother named her Nerwen, which means man-maiden, because she's just so darn birch. Like, whoever you are, dear viewer, Tolkien's version of Galadriel could probably beat you up. This is one of my favourite things about Galadriel. She's imposing. She has a powerful presence, whether you're a hobbit or an elf. So, here's our 6'4" tall, deep-voiced Galadriel for Amazon Prime Video.
You have not seen what I've seen.
Guess they were going for that whole small person against impossible odds thing. One thing I've always loved about Lord of the Rings is the androgyny. You have a whole race of people, the elves, who are extremely androgynous. Pretty much no one can grow a beard, and many of the women are canonically as strong as the men. The women are often older than their husbands too, and Galadriel is at least as tall as hers. And then on the other hand, you have the dwarves, who are also androgynous, but they're traditionally masculine and rough, and even the women seem to have beards, and they're still amazing and powerful and strong in their own ways. It's always felt to me as if these two races embody the extreme polar opposites of gender expression, and I love it. There are no strictly gendered features in this world. And then Rings of Power is like, yeah, but actually how boys and girls work is girls are pretty and boys have short hair, so. Half the male elves make me feel like I'm getting rickrolled, and some of them have straight up undercuts, which I can only assume are maintained by magic. Elrond is apparently so committed to his short hair that there is a painting proving that he has had that short hair for about 1500 years, so there must be an elven hairdresser somewhere where he's a very loyal customer. And although I love Disa in Rings of Power, and I think the actress is actually giving one of the best performances in the show by far, I was a little bummed that they couldn't bring themselves to give her more of a beard. And what little sideburns they gave her, they actually designed her hair to cover them up. Just feels cowardly. And actually, you know what? While I want to say that all female elves have long hair, I can't verify that because Galadriel is the only female elf in the main cast, and almost all other female elves are unnamed veiled servants. Their hairstyles are so heavily gendered in this show that not only do men have mostly short hair and women long hair, but the only woman with short hair in the show is an evil gender-bending shapeshifter. She's not even a real character, she's just evil and androgynous. I mean, thank God for representation, but you know. So the person we all thought was Sauron because they looked like a gender-fucked twink turned out to be a generic evil woman, and Sauron turned out to be the most bland Aragorn knockoff imaginable. I think Tolkien would have seen actress Morfydd Clark as horribly miscast when his vision of Galadriel had much more in common with Gwendolyn Christie. Imagine her as Galadriel. Sure, when Cate Blanchett played Galadriel in the original film trilogy, she wasn't especially tall, but she definitely felt tall, and you can hear how deep Blanchett is making her voice for the character.
I know what it is you saw.
It's a far cry from the tiny little Morfydd Clark. No offense to Clark, she's clearly doing a fine job, but she's miscast in a role meant for an actress who could perhaps eat her in one gulp. Rings of Power has really erased the unusual aspects of gender in Tolkien, which have so much potential for subverting Hollywood's beauty standards. There could have been a version of this where the dwarf women have straight up beards, and Galadriel is fucking huge, and elf men are as pretty as the day is long. So why is Galadriel such a tiny, tiny lady in Rings of Power? Well, I've got a theory about that. See, one of the other changes that they've made to Galadriel is that they've taken her husband Celeborn out of the picture, and they don't mention her daughter at all. She's traumatized by the loss of her brother, but she doesn't seem particularly bothered by the apparent death of her husband. He just gets a brief mention in episode 7. She's also young and wild. They make a point of kind of infantilizing her. Elendil, who is like 1,000 years younger than her, compares her to his kids.
I have a daughter who runs fast and a son who runs blind. Your eyes bear a striking resemblance to both.
So, what's the point of these changes? Well, for the sake of a ship.
I would make you a queen.
They want us to ship Galadriel with Sauron, and I reckon they felt that was easier to do if Celeborn was out of the picture and she was young and petite rather than towering over Sauron.
Halbrand.
Don't start.
Maybe they felt like exploring Galadriel's trauma over the loss of her brother would make her feel more akin to Eowyn with her own struggles with depression. But what worked about Eowyn was that she was an underdog in a similar way to Frodo. Eowyn faces oppressive forces all around her, sometimes from Saruman and Wormtongue, sometimes because she's a girl and a woman's place is in the home. Her people aren't even the great race of Numenoreans, she's just a horse lady from Rohan. She rises to glory despite all these things and helps save Middle-earth. Galadriel doesn't have those barriers. Galadriel is a very special elf of the great and powerful Noldor, and she does whatever she wants. She's powerful, strong, smart, she doesn't experience gender discrimination, she's supposed to be the ruler of all Eregion. And despite the fact that she's a conspiracy theorist making it up as she goes along, she's more or less right about everything, and everyone should have listened to her from the start. Galadriel in the Second Age just doesn't work as a Tolkien-esque underdog. The orc father Adar is more of an underdog trying to find a homeland for his children after being enslaved. Sauron is more of an underdog. Actually, Sauron has the weirdest story in this season. To begin with, he's stuck on a raft with some people who seem relatively unfussed by the fact that they're hanging out with basically the devil's boyfriend. Keep in mind, Sauron is of the same race as Gandalf and Saruman and the Balrog. He's a powerful motherfucker, and this is before he put his power into the ring, so he's really like at the height of his strength, but for some reason he's like, oh poor me, I'm stuck on a raft, my life is so hard. And then when he gets to Numenor, he's just like trying to find a job to make an honest living, but unfortunately his temper gets the best of him sometimes and he runs into trouble. Wacky old Sauron. He gets roped into Galadriel's quest to go to Mordor, which you would think that's where he wants to go, but when he's wounded, instead of slipping out of the picture, he hangs around and goes to Eregion with Galadriel, where he's like, hey, listen, I think you're really cute, and I'd really like it if you were my queen. And she's like, no, I'm just really not that into you. So he like walks to Mordor. So what the fuck is happening? Why does Sauron spend a whole season just aimlessly wandering about Middle-earth? Well, it's because the whole season has been written around the question, which character is Sauron? Is it A, Evil McEvilson, the mysterious goth leader of the orcs taking over Mordor? Or is it B, the stranger, a mysterious guy who looks and acts like Gandalf? Is it C, non-binary Eminem? Or is it D, the guy who was obviously Sauron from the very beginning? Rings of Power follows a trend of high-budget films and shows made in complete secrecy to protect the spoilers. The writer's room for Rings of Power was a windowless bunker protected by guards and fingerprint scanners. One critic said, it seems like the performances are so inconsistent, it feels almost as if the actors weren't told what kind of show they're in. And you know what? That's entirely possible, because some of them didn't even know who they were playing in the show until they got to New Zealand. The whole point of these secret special reveals is to give the viewers a sense of urgency and the show more weight than it really has. People who otherwise aren't really in a rush to watch more of this crap will still tune in because they don't want to get it spoiled. But when you center your show around reveals, you sacrifice proper story. Romeo and Juliet opens with a spoiler, but that doesn't ruin the play for you, does it? So everyone's stories end up being about the big Sauron reveal. Galadriel is infantilized and widowed so we can ship her with Halbrand before he comes out as Sauron. Nori's mystery of who is the stranger is just a red herring to make us wonder if the stranger is really Sauron. Bronwyn's village and life are destroyed so we can introduce Adar, who looks goth enough to be Sauron. All of these characters who are praised for finally centering women in Middle-earth are actually all about supporting Sauron's ridiculous odyssey, and even he is not a real character because his story doesn't make any sense. He's just a reveal to make you watch now so you don't get a spoiler. Following the tried and tested Tolkien formula was just never an option for Rings of Power because it doesn't depend on the power of good storytelling, it depends on shocking television that will get you tweeting. Well, they needn't have worried because everyone was already tweeting about Rings of Power, but probably not for the reason they were hoping for. Race is a sweating emoji kind of complicated in Lord of the Rings. Tolkien came from an era when it was believed by many that the aristocracy was from a better genetic lineage than the poor. For many, race lines could be drawn by class, and that is definitely visible in Middle-earth. Aragorn, the original Nepo baby, is literally genetically racially superior to his subjects, being ethnically Dunedain is what makes him more suitable to lead. His line of descent comes from Beren and Luthien, meaning he is mostly of the race of men, but he has some elf in him and also some Maia. That's the kind of angelic race that Gandalf and Sauron both come from. So you have these great races who are fair and beautiful and powerful, and then you have lesser men, and then orcs. It's kind of like the great chain of being, elves at the top, men below them, which includes hobbits, and of course orcs at the bottom. And before anyone tries to justify this by saying orcs aren't really people, they're just animals, no. Men, elves, and orcs are all canonically capable of creating fertile offspring together, so they can't be different species, they're racial groups of one single species. Aragorn could totally have a baby with an orc, because we know some humans did. And when put in those terms, things start to get uncomfortable. Orcs have their own personalities, they have their own culture. Apparently the Peter Jackson orcs have restaurants since they know what a menu is.
Looks like meat back on the menu, boys!
They might be ugly, they might be mean, but just because a person is mean and ugly doesn't mean they don't deserve human rights. Not to mention that they are usually described as having dark skin tones. They're the archetypical other. They're there to be disposable, a race of people you can kill without a thought. A trope in a lot of fantasy or sci-fi, think zombies or Thanos' disposable army of aliens in the Avengers. It's okay to kill them and not have an existential crisis. Peter Parker didn't have a problem activating instant kill mode and just going on a murder spree. God, that child definitely has PTSD. As four-time Hugo Award-winning fantasy author N.K. Jemisin puts it, orcs are human beings who can be slaughtered without conscience or apology. Only way to deal with them is to control them utterly a la slavery, or wipe them all out. Huh. Sounds familiar. But unlike zombies or ambiguous aliens, the orcs have names. They are individuals. There's even a scene where some orcs discuss running off together and leaving Sauron so they can have a quieter life. We ship Gorbag and Shagrat, let them live together in peace, Tolkien. These guys are definitely just people. They just happen to be a people who are ugly and inherently evil, so killing them is morally good. But what happens to the mummy orcs and the baby orcs? Surely they're not left alive when Aragorn orders the extermination of orcs. Any excuse you can think of for killing a race of people has been thought of and used by racists to oppress and kill races of real people. And so has the kind of language used by Tolkien to dehumanize the orcs. From this perspective, it all has uncomfortable parallels, especially considering it was mostly written in the 1930s and 40s. But actually, Tolkien was not a fan of the Nazis. He was definitely not a white supremacist or a fascist. He hated Hitler, he hated colonialism and imperialism, he was opposed to apartheid. But none of that stops the orcs feeling pretty friggin' racist. So the thing is, Tolkien intended for the orcs to be more symbolic than genuinely racial. Their darkness and their otherness are spiritual, symbolic darkness. Light and dark are major symbols in the series, and people are sometimes described as being dark even when they're not actually meant to be dark. There are dark-skinned people in Middle-earth, such as the Easterlings and the Haradrim, and they are also working for Sauron, though it's implied he tricked them into servitude.
You wonder what his name is, where he came from, if he was really evil at heart, what lies or threats led him on this long march from home.
But Tolkien also frequently refers to the Ringwraiths as black men or black riders, and that's definitely not a reference to race, as they are white people who are just goths, really. Similar to the symbolic racialization of the orcs, the hobbits represent metaphorically small English country people. They are an embodiment of Tolkien's quote about small people against impossible odds. He doesn't believe English country people are literally smaller than, like, the monarchy, but society certainly might consider them to be so. So the orcs are not meant to represent a real-world racial group either. In real life, when Tolkien would hear the sound of a chainsaw, he'd yell, "Orc!" Or if he saw a motorbike passing, he'd be like, "There's an orc!" He basically just didn't like technology, or loud stuff. He also described wars as having orcs on both sides, because orcishness was not a real representation of race to him, but of the darkness inside of us, inside of anyone. But this means that when someone like Peter Jackson tries to adapt the books to films, we get heroes who look like this, and villains who look like this, and that is, at best, uncomfortable. A whole trilogy where all heroes are white and the darkest skinned people are evil disposable monsters. It's just fucked up. I know people revere Jackson's films as incredibly accurate adaptations, and they are great films, but really he converted the books into an action adventure with a dash of horror for spice. He drew out battle scenes and reveled in the vicious killing of the orcs. They're great films, but this was an interpretation and Jackson made choices. I don't think Sam ever calls Frodo master in the films because that is super uncomfortable. Jackson made choices. This world of racially superior aristocracies and races of pure evil that must be stamped out just doesn't reflect our cultural values, and that needs to be considered when translating the books to the big screen. Because the fact is, white supremacists love Lord of the Rings. White heroes wiping out dark-skinned foes is very appealing to them, and Tolkien really did not do anything to offset that. But despite Tolkien's own issues with understanding race, he does seem to have been capable of change. So on multiple occasions, Tolkien compared the dwarves to Jews.
The dwarves, of course, quite obviously. Couldn't you say in many ways they remind you of the Jews?
Oh, Johnny Runny, why are you like this? It's not clear how much he considered the dwarves to be allegorical Jews, but what is clear is that if you look at his earliest portrayals of the dwarves written in the 1910s and 20s, they are characterized as monstrous, greedy creatures. But if you look at the dwarves in the 1930s and 40s, how they appeared in The Hobbit and then The Lord of the Rings, they gradually become noble and heroic. Indeed, Gimli and Legilulu's bromance was written in the 1940s during the Second World War, a tale of people of different races whose ancestors didn't get along, finding friendship in each other. With the rise of Nazism, British attitudes towards Jewish people changed dramatically for the better, and it seems so did Tolkien's attitude towards the dwarves. Now, obviously, this whole thing of comparing Jews to magical dwarves is really, really not great. But it seems to illustrate that Tolkien was capable of changing with the times, of growing and learning. He was a bit of a dickhead, but a dickhead capable of change. And if that's his legacy, then I think Lord of the Rings deserves to do the same in his absence. If he were alive today, it's possible he would have continued to grow and learn and would agree that white supremacists having used Lord of the Rings as a point to get people interested in their cause is horrible and horrifying. So if Tolkien was capable of changing his own work with the times, how do we go about adapting Lord of the Rings now? The Rings of Power has given us pale orcs, which the head of the Rings of Power's prosthetic department has said is because they're younger orcs. So I guess that's their reasoning for the difference between these guys and the Peter Jackson orcs, so they'll get darker as they age. But I imagine at least part of the intention is to avoid any connotations of them as a dark-skinned racial group. But interestingly, Amazon has actually leaned into some of the other racial aspects of the orcs. The orcs are descended from an elf named Adar. He and the other elves were enslaved by Morgoth and bred to create the orcs. So they are a sort of racial or ethnic group of elves who are just plain evil. This is true to Tolkien's ideas about the origins of the orcs, or at least one of his ideas, because Tolkien had created a problem with the orcs which he struggled with for the rest of his life. He was a Catholic and believed that all people had a soul, and if the orcs were just a group of people, then how could they not have a soul? He played with various ideas of them as almost like zombies or mindless puppets or automatons or non-human animals. This would allow us to see them as soulless so we could have more fun killing them, which worked fine in early drafts of the Silmarillion, but didn't work so well in The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, where they were clearly characterized as individuals. The final version of them that we get is this idea that they were corrupted elves, which Peter Jackson adopted for his films. But interestingly, Jackson also went for this weird, gross horror birth, where the orcs apparently gestate in the mud and come out as adults. I think maybe for Jackson, the idea of orc mummies and orc babies was a little too horrific, so this is what we got. Rings of Power has tried to position itself as a prequel not so much to the books, but to Peter Jackson's films. So I guess we've got to go for the orcs as corrupted elves thing for Rings of Power too. So we have early orcs with their ancestor, Adar. They've been enslaved and bred by Sauron's ex-boyfriend Morgoth, but they're now freed from their slavery and trying to take over Mordor so they can just live their lives, I guess. And Galadriel's like, ew, no, I'm gonna literally kill all of you.
Your kind was a mistake. And even if it takes me all of this age, I vow to eradicate every last one of you.
So that's genocide, isn't it? That she's gonna slaughter an enslaved people, which, as far as attempts to remove racism from Lord of the Rings go, it's an interesting choice. And there's no way to go against that narrative because this is a prequel. So we know that this genocide will happen no matter what. No matter what happens in the Rings of Power, in the Lord of the Rings, we will see all of the orcs wiped out, and it's considered a good thing. But that's not the part of the show people are freaking out about. We aren't too fussed about a cheeky bit of genocide. What most people are upset about is what appears to be colorblind casting. In Hollywood, it's common these days to increase diversity through making older properties but with actors of color and through colorblind casting. And this, thankfully, increases employment opportunities for actors of color, but has also been criticized as being sort of the simplest version of visibility. Definitely check out Kristen Warner's work on this for more. With colorblind casting, you don't have to think too much about cultural specificity or, you know, dimensional characterization, and you get to avoid making any major changes to your intellectual property while placating critics and and also obscuring the fact that behind the scenes you have just white men running everything. And Rings of Power is definitely eager to do all of those things, but colorblind casting in Rings of Power is definitely a better move than giving us all white heroes and basically creating hundreds of jobs that are like only for white people. But again, Rings of Power is positioning itself as a prequel to the Peter Jackson films, so how much colorblind casting is actually happening here? Galadriel is white in Jackson's trilogy, so she has to be white in this version too. So does Elrond and I guess Gandalf. Gil-galad appears in the background as a white guy too. And I guess because Elrond, Galadriel and Gil-galad are cousins, they decided to make their other cousin Celebrimbor white too. I don't know how much of a conscious decision this was, but it does end up meaning that anyone who made it to Valinor, so basically heaven, the heaven of Middle-earth, is a white person. Even the unnamed children playing in Valinor all seem to be white. This goes for the Maiar too, who came from Valinor. Sauron is white, Gandalf is white, as Saruman was white in the original trilogy. I guess the Balrog is a Maiar and it isn't white, but that's okay. Well, the only elf in the main cast played by a person of color is Arondir, a character invented for the show who is not a Noldor. He's a Sylvan elf, which means his ancestors never made it to Valinor and aren't considered as great as Galadriel's family. And where Galadriel's family is the aristocratic royal Noldor, Arondir is like a security guard or a cop who's been stationed in Mordor for like 80 years. Actors of color do seem to be almost exclusively cast in roles invented for the show, with the exception of Miriel, who is, spoiler alert, destined to drown to death. It seems like the showrunners were very conscious of race in Middle-earth, and considering that they are trying to build up to Peter Jackson's world of all white people, the casting may have not really been all that colorblind. Though maybe it was for the Harfords, who in the books are described as browner of skin, and they are definitely diversely cast in the show, but it is interesting that the main Harford, Nori, is played by a blonde white woman who definitely is not browner of skin. It kind of reminds me of the old Earthsea adaptation where colorblind casting actually just so happened to mean that Ged, a brown guy, was now played by a white guy. Guess he was just the best man for the job. And it's interesting that in casting the fair and beautiful, canonically pale Noldor, Amazon was like, okay, so they are all white, even though some of them are canonically mixed race and they live in massive cities and socialize with various races and other elf groups. But when it came to the canonically browner, tiny, isolated ethnic group scared of strangers, they were like, it's important to give all people an opportunity, even white people. Furthermore, the Harfords' Irish accent is used to make them sound sweet and primitive.
There's wonders in this world, beyond our wandering.
While the elves use posh English accents.
The undying lands of Valinor.
And the orcs, on the other hand, speak with Cockney accents.
You've just earned your company. A water ration.
It's connoting these hideous working class monsters against the beautiful aristocratic elves. Even if that's consistent with Tolkien's writing, we've definitely moved beyond these stereotypes, or I would have hoped we have. So in the end, we have a show which is an adaptation from a series of films which has problems with race, because they were adapted from a series of books which had problems with race, and it's trying very hard to be loyal to both, while avoiding any accusations of racism. But Amazon seems to not have realized that race in Tolkien's work extends to class, because he saw on some level a racial component to class, and that racial class distinction is definitely explicit in Rings of Power. It is good that they've created a more diverse Middle-earth, but the problem of race in this world goes much deeper than they seem to have realized. When deciding who to sell the Lord of the Rings TV rights to, the Tolkien estate didn't choose the highest bidder, they chose Amazon, reportedly because Amazon's also a shop, and the estate hoped this would mean lots and lots of book sales. And of course Amazon also has ulterior motives with their whole video department. Unlike other streamers, their business model doesn't simply rely on paying to make a show and then making the money back by selling the show to viewers. Their whole empire is centered around their core retail business. For example, they sell Echoes way under price because they're hoping you're going to use the Echoes to order way more goods from their shop. In the same way, Amazon Video exists to give you a reason to subscribe to Amazon Prime. Prime subscribers spend more than twice as much on Amazon than customers who don't have Prime. Once you've subscribed to watch Rings of Power, and you just happen to have this sweet free shipping deal, you might as well use it to buy the new Rings of Power tie-in editions of the books, right? Or a Hobbit mug, or a Frodo Funko Pop. With all these services so cheap and convenient, you've become a loyal customer already. Amazon knows how to run a store, and they're walking toward how to make media work. If they can marry the two, Everyone else in the media business will start to scramble. Everything about Rings of Power was a carefully calculated business decision. You've got a prequel to one of the biggest film franchises of all time, so you've got that nostalgia factor. You know how to leverage spoiler culture to your advantage. You understand that creating a convoluted and lore-heavy narrative no one understands guarantees lots of coverage in the cottage industry of online explainers, which provides more free promotion for your show. You also know that these days, diverse films are way more profitable than those without diversity, and you know that by hiring leads that are women and people of color, you can avert attention from the fact that behind the scenes, nothing has changed and Hollywood is still mainly run by white men. So you end up with these shallow female characters that feel tokenized even when they're in the lead roles, and when it comes to the monumental job of addressing racism in Middle Earth, you get some interesting choices. There's a difference between just plonking a strong female character in your story and actually considering what Middle Earth would look like from a woman's perspective or through a feminist lens. There's a difference between selective colorblind casting and actually reinterpreting race in Middle Earth in a meaningful way. Meaningful, resonant diversity is a more difficult, underdeveloped approach that requires all stakeholders to think harder about what on-screen difference looks and feels like. People have been really beside themselves that this show wasn't true to Tolkien's vision, but is that really the problem? I think we like to search for truth in fiction. We want worlds like Middle-earth to be real, so we want an adaptation to be truly faithful to the original work, because we like to think there's some sacred truth in it. Like, if it brings me so much joy, how can that text not contain some kind of truth? But if you look at Lord of the Rings in context, there is both truth and some bollocks. Tolkien's confusion about how race works is some bullshit. He was a bit racist because he was ignorant and just straight up confused about how genetics work. But what he learned about love and loss through his life, through war and death and romance, those themes speak truth and are the reason so many of us admire his work. There is a truth to Frodo's journey and his trauma that speaks to the generations who survived the world wars. And of course, one of the greatest and most feminist stories in his work is that of Beren and Lúthien, the star-crossed story of a man and an elf falling in love, inspired by Tolkien's own forbidden romance with his wife Edith. That story then went on to inspire Aragorn and Arwen too. The names Beren and Lúthien are now written on Tolkien and Edith's headstone. That is one of the sacred truths of Lord of the Rings. Tolkien spent half a century building this incredibly detailed world, not totally from scratch, but sometimes from his own life, sometimes from existing mythologies and fairy tales, all serving his incredible invented languages. You can't replicate the success of a work like that by throwing money at some random guys for a few years and making Twitter scared of spoilers. I think there could be a great adaptation of Tolkien's work out there someday, but it's not going to be now, not while companies like Amazon own the rights and the story belongs to a very limited demographic of creators. Tolkien hated greed. He hated imperialism. He hated Disney and the commercialization of fairy tales. He would have deeply hated Jeff Bezos and Amazon and undoubtedly the Rings of Power TV series. In a few more decades, The Lord of the Rings will come into the public domain, and after most of a century of influencing fantasy, I think that's where it belongs, in the public domain with the myths that inspired it, not in the hands of dragons who hoard their wealth in hollow mountains. I look forward to a time soon when The Lord of the Rings will truly belong to everyone, and I hope someday we'll get to see versions of this world through the eyes of marginalized creators. If you like this video, please consider supporting the channel via Patreon. It's the best way to support our work. Otherwise, consider liking and subscribing and maybe sharing the video. That would be really nice. Thank you. Thank you to all of our patrons, and a very special thanks to Andrew Cokemore, Angela, Ariel Rodriguez, Besna Plaza, Cleo McKeever, Corwin Found, Didruel, Erica Ligren, Fluffy Bunny Boo, Gamer Guy J, Gwenda Euphoria, Helena Barbarousis, Joe Liss, Juliana Backer, Kyle Denley, Machina X Domina, Meg, Mia Nilo, Matheta, Nathan Temequil, Nina Vangberg, Nononymous, River Felix, Selenia Latovara, Siobhan Fox, Stephen Wallace, Talia Parkinson, Taylor White, Abigail Eckstein, Aaron, AJ Mango, Alice, Alice Lovell, All Ducks Rock, Amelia D, Anya Stephen, Anton North, Arden, Artemix, Avery Otte, B, Basute, Ben Hengst, Beslaf, Beth, Byrunny, Break Every Yoke, Bump Girl, Simwa, Kane Friedman, Carson Harder Hyde, Casey Boisvert, Katrina Lexi, Charis Edwards, Charlotte Hollingsworth, Chelsea S, Chloe G, Chloe Strange, CJ Gibson, Claire, Colleen French, Comfort and Adam, David, Dax, Deanna McMillan, Devon as usual, Dufolezerin 120416, Dorothy, Dr. Most Beautiful Duck, Dropout Ninja, Etu Darren, Eden Ladley, Iri Enby, Elizabeth Early, Eliza, L Like the L Word, Elora Walmisley, Elsie Astro, Emma Bales, Emery James Fairgrieve, Erica Nieslund, Eve Griffith, Faye Crossroads, Fancy Angles, Fickle Harpy, Gabriella Day, Gavin Salmon, Gerald Brenter, Ghost and You Might Die, Ginger, Grace Robertson, Grisela Farben, Guillaume Pires, Hayley LeBang, Hertzville, Ira Zenon, Jackie Queen of Thieves, Jam Kwasowski, Jamie Midge, Jennifer Fronister, Julian D, Joe McManus, Joey Mayer, Jose Suazo, Jules Inkwell, Julio Liotte, Julio Mendez, Julius Sarwin, Juniper Lopez, Kale, Kaleidoscopic, Carnelius, Katharina Glomb, Kitty Bollinger, Katya, Kaysera, Kelly Flynn, Kelp, Chris P, Laura Carver, Lewis McLeod, Lee Hedstrom, Lindsay Mercer, Liren E, Lisa Spitalovitz, Logan K, Lumpy Llama, Mary Bass, Mario, Marla Nolting, Mama Reed, Marim, Math Class Warfare, Malka, Maxim Shulin, McKenning Wood, Megan Fauci, Metabor, Mo, Mochibun, Modest Martian, Mugsy, Moomin Muppet, Moshe Gordon Radian, Runmai Salil, Mirren McGlynn, Neve, Nico, Nick Snary, Nina, Nora Carlson, Nullbuild, Olioli1234, Ophelia, Austin Mathieu, Pani Lin, Paul Stevenson, Potato King, Pseudo Pac-Man, Public L, Rachel Ratt, Rochelle, Radical Planning, Rebecca Peacock, Reese Enghart, River Haddock, RSS, Ruxandra Greco, Sarah Buchelman, Sarah R, Saria, Shockstopia, Sean Haskett, Sean, She Algorithm, Shira the Nerd, Sierra Kaplan Nelson, Sierra Rhodes, Sylvia, Simon Martin, Simon Patience, Sithvich, Suhum Banerjee, Sophie, Stevie L, Summertime Killer, Susie S, T. Thomas, Tara Hilliard, Teb9893, Tenebrosi, The Adamantine Sky Pirate, Theo Falling, Thistlecat, Tiago, Tim Anderson, Tiny Wooden Tree, Tom Harrison, Troisier, Valeria, Verlux, Vicious Panda, Vince Whittaker, Wandering Sock, Wards, Wesley Botham, Will O'Connor, Jonathan Zunger, and Zet.